TikTok is one of the most popular social media platforms the world has ever seen. When you're using the app, it's easy to see why. Once you start scrolling through the short bursts of videos, it's difficult to stop. I've been using the app over the past few years, and like most other users, I'm addicted. At first, the platform was mainly music lip sync and dance videos. But now, when you open TikTok, there's content to satisfy whatever interests.
What has TikTok diagnosed you with? I will go first. ADHD.
And since the end of 2022, I've noticed videos about darker topics going viral quickly.
You have blood on your hands! You have blood on your hands!
So, like everybody else on TikTok, I'm obsessed.
They stole a bus and burned it.
TikTok now has 1 billion regular users, drawing millions of eyeballs and spawning all kinds of content at a scale and speed vastly beyond other social media apps. So I wanted to find out, what is TikTok's unprecedented success doing to us? I'm Marianna Spring, the BBC's disinformation and social media correspondent, and this is BBC Trending. In this series, we're investigating how social media is pushing its users to the extreme with serious consequences. Earlier in the series, we looked at a wave of gruesome AI-generated TikTok videos of murdered children. But in this episode, I'm investigating how TikTok's addictive algorithm and unique format is whipping people up into frenzies connected to antisocial behaviour offline. Users seem to be encountering content they wouldn't have before and behaving in unusual ways. In November 2022, my TikTok was flooded with videos about gruesome crime in a place I'd never heard of before. It didn't come up on my other social media profiles, and it was yet to receive widespread media attention.
Four students stabbed to death in their off-campus house while two of their housemates slept. Those are the bare facts of a crime committed on the 13th of November in the small college town of Moscow, Idaho.
Within days of the murders, my For You page was inundated with content about the deaths of Zana Knodel, Ethan Chapin, Kaylee Gonsalves, and Madison Mogan, dubbed the Idaho Four. A month after the murders, a suspect was in custody, but in the meantime, fervent and sometimes defamatory speculation over who the perpetrator was gripped TikTok. TikTok was uniquely obsessed with the case. Looking at the Idaho 4 hashtag, videos on TikTok racked up 2 billion views, compared to just 80,000 views on YouTube over the same time period, and far more than the other social media sites too. True crime online is nothing new, but this seemed to be reaching new extremes. TikTok has community guidelines its users have to follow or they risk being suspended or banned. But it seems to be a free-for-all when users want to share speculation on cases like Idaho.
My TikTok right now has 1.2 million followers, and then I have a backup account that has about 700,000.
That's Olivia. She's a true crime vlogger from Florida and was one of the most prominent creators uploading content about this case. I travelled to Anna Maria Island in Florida, where I met her at her home, close to the beaches with golden sand and clear blue water. A similar age to the victims, Olivia said she was drawn to the murders.
The manner that it happened was so brutal and so shocking. That's not something that you see every day. And I just felt this need to go out there and dig for answers and see if I can help out in any way.
Olivia clearly takes a lot of time editing her TikTok videos. They're slickly produced. They remind me of trailers you'd see for true crime series on Netflix. She'd been posting true crime videos for years, but her post about the Idaho 4 had taken her audience to new levels. One of the TikTok videos racked up 20 million views.
That frenzy does happen with TikTok because one little bit of information can be spread out rapidly within an hour or less to a lot of people because that's how the algorithm of TikTok works.
So why do these frenzies happen on TikTok?
I was a really early adopter of the platform and I couldn't put it down. Started to see more of my friends joining and just saw it as not going away and I just needed to be a part of it.
Taylor Cohen worked as a global creative strategist at TikTok in the US between 2020 and 2022. She does a great job explaining why the app is so difficult to put down compared to others.
TikTok is a content graph, meaning that it's the algorithm serves you content based on topics you like. So As an example, if you really like dogs and you start to see, you know, maybe one or two TikToks in your feed of dogs, but you're always liking that dog post, you're going to start to see a lot more dog content in your feed. Now on Instagram, the biggest difference there is, you know, that's a social graph, meaning you're only going to see content based upon other people's influence. So your other friends liking posts, you know, how many followers the person has, how much engagement they're getting.
When you post a video on TikTok, rather than it just being promoted to your friends and followers, it will appear on the feeds of other users who TikTok thinks could be interested in it. Depending on how they engage with that video, the algorithm might decide this is something people like and push it to millions more at a speed and scale not possible on other social media platforms. After seeing the original video's success, other users might then decide to create their own versions, which in turn will be sent out to more people, and the cycle starts again. And so you have a TikTok frenzy, often with users coming across content they wouldn't have encountered before, and behaving in unusual ways because they think seeing others doing it means it's okay to do the same. And that's what happened in Olivia's case. She decided to take her content further, traveling all the way from Florida to Idaho to make videos from the crime scene.
Moscow, Idaho is about a 6 or 7 hour flight, I think. I was at the location for a week, talking to people, to neighbors, to students, and trying to get a feel for the town, the atmosphere, and like also getting a feel for what type of people live there too, and who could have possibly done this.
While Olivia's videos and similar content had lots of fans, they also received criticism from some TikTokers, Idaho locals, and those who were falsely accused of involvement in the murders.
It's not a game of Clue. People died. Stop.
And we shouldn't sensationalize murders like this, because there were so many victims that were created through internet sleuth videos like this.
It is insanely disrespectful to go ahead and make a little mock documentary for a 15-second TikTok video of an active crime.
I was taken aback by how far Olivia has been willing to take this. It's almost like she doesn't realise the harm this kind of unfounded speculation and invasive tactics cause to the people living through tragedies, same as the other users getting involved in these frenzies. I asked her whether she could see why some people may think her actions were abnormal.
I do see how that could be unusual for people that aren't on TikTok, but I think it's a new thing that is happening and it will become more normal. It's the beginning, it's kind of like the Wild West out here.
When I spoke to someone who used to work at TikTok, they said they could see these frenzies happening in real time. Jasmine was a TikTok moderator for 6 months in 2022. Her role was to sift through content on the platform and remove videos that went against TikTok's guidelines.
I think it's fair to say that TikTok has a unique quality to it that makes it especially sticky for people to engage in trends, because you feel like everyone else is already doing it. So what does it matter if I also show up to this crime scene or if I also engage in this trend? You could see it as a moderator that people would completely pivot their content and kind of try to jump on whatever is trendy right now.
I put these points to TikTok, and a spokesperson for the company told me, at moments of national conversation, which are intensified by 24-hour news reporting, we naturally see our community take more of an interest in these stories, just as everyone does, whether they're around a kitchen table or at a bus stop. The BBC itself has posted on TikTok about many of the stories covered in this documentary. It wasn't long before I spotted something else strange taking over a completely different corner of the app.
So-called TikTok protests have continued to take place in Britain's schools as hundreds of pupils rebelled against teachers over new rules, with some clips attracting millions of views.
In February 2023, students at a school in Merseyside, England, protested against school uniform checks and posted about it on TikTok. Within 3 days, there had been protests staged and filmed in 60 schools around the UK. Within a week, this number grew to 100. These were more than just students exercising their right to protest. There were examples of smashed windows, trees set on fire, and teachers assaulted. Several schools were forced to call the police. And soon there were new protests against asking to go to the toilet with loos and cubicles damaged. It all felt quite familiar to me. This outbreak of disorder had many of the characteristics of a frenzy. The sheer speed at which the post spread on TikTok to users who likely wouldn't have encountered this content before, and the way users felt emboldened to participate. According to TikTok, most of the videos showed pupils engaging in peaceful demonstrations, but teachers and students I was speaking to were concerned about the accumulative effect of all of the videos.
Most of the worrying videos we would see were by really young users. These kind of like frenzies of like what is currently cool to do in a school has like always been the case, even when I was in school. But I feel like what TikTok is enabling people to do now is to take one thing that's viral in one school and transporting it to like the whole region and making it a competition and who can up the other schools and make it more extreme.
While the protests were going on, I wanted to figure out what the TikTok algorithm was feeding teenagers in the UK. So I set up an undercover account and mirrored interests typical of a 15-year-old boy. All I did was watch and like videos. I didn't comment or message anyone. The fourth post that came up was an influencer called Adrian. As well as more mundane videos and comedy sketches, he shares clips under the guise of self-improvement that seem to be encouraging antisocial behaviour in schools. Over the next few days, the algorithm drove more and more of his content like this to the undercover account.
There was a massive rollout of assemblies across the UK talking about how much of a bad influence I am. You know school is pointless and you know it's not helping you prepare for your future one little bit. Having to ask to go to the toilet in schools is honestly one of the most abominable things.
Some of his videos had comments underneath from pupils suggesting they'd been disciplined by their schools as a result of following Adrian's advice. One read, "Thank you, brother, I've just been suspended." And another said he was almost sent to isolation after refusing to ask to go to the toilet. I spoke to Adrian and asked him if he felt like his videos had encouraged antisocial behaviour in schools.
With great power comes great responsibility. I mean, I've got a massive list of people who are watching my videos every single day, and I absolutely have to think about what I'm putting on the internet and the potential damages behind it. Do I think I had any impact on those particular things you listed? Absolutely not. If you look at my following, let's say I've got 1.2 million followers on that account, let's say of which, let's chop it down to 800k are school children. How many of those children realistically were involved in those acts? I mean, a tiny, tiny percentage. I can't control that. I think to say that social media and TikTok in particular, or my content, is to blame for these things, it's completely false.
I contacted many of the schools affected by the protests. None of them wanted to be interviewed about it, but several teachers expressed concerns about the link between TikTok and what was happening. What was interesting about the school's protest to me is that it exemplified how TikTok encourages users to do more than just watch videos and to actually take part in trends on the platform.
TikTok inspires participation more than any other platform. If anything, I truly believe it is the participatory platform.
It wasn't long before TikTok was receiving more scrutiny on the world stage for the part it can play in driving offline behaviour.
Protests and unrest erupted in the region around Paris overnight after police shot dead a 17-year-old who failed to stop when ordered to by traffic police.
17-year-old Nahel M was fatally shot in the chest at point-blank range by police after driving off during a traffic check in West Paris. Anger about the police's actions and accusations of racism fueled protests, with many calling for justice for Nahel. But alongside legitimate demonstrations came violence, looting and rioting across the country. The French president, Emmanuel Macron, laid some of the blame for the riots in the wake of his killing on TikTok and Snapchat.
The social network platforms have played a very conspicuous part in the events in the last couple of days, and these videos have intoxicated the young people.
I looked through the content spreading on social media using Nahel's name. On Snapchat, I found public videos racking up over 160,000 views. That doesn't include private chats I can't access. Even so, TikTok videos using this hashtag racked up more than 850 million views, a vast number in comparison. Quite a few of the TikToks were Snapchat videos reshared, getting a much larger reach on TikTok than just friends or those who live locally. A former insider at TikTok, who we're calling Lucas, and who has been voiced up by an actor to protect his identity, says the platform struggles with moderating content around social unrest like this.
The French protests don't surprise me. TikTok can definitely drive more eyeballs in a way that escalates situations. I do think it can validate behaviour. Groupthink is very real, especially in places like TikTok. I do think TikTok wants to de-amplify content that's explicitly dangerous, but it doesn't want to overly censor or slow things down which are developing as viral, and that can be a tricky line to walk. But on the other hand, TikTok can make people aware of protests in a positive way too.
Of course, this isn't the first time tensions between residents and the police have led to rioting in France. And Macron has faced criticism for laying some of the blame for unrest at social media's door. Protests are also the sign of a functioning democracy, where people can express their views and opposition. But these riots, which seem to spread like wildfire, were accompanied by unusually destructive behaviour. After spotting several TikToks showing violence and devastation in a town called Viry-Châtillon, I travelled there to figure out whether a TikTok frenzy was to blame.
Bonjour.
Bonjour Marianna, bienvenue à Viry.
Merci beaucoup. Merci.
So le bus, il était en il l'avait mis en travers.
The bus was, they put the bus across. They put it across both roads here, right in the middle. They took people out. They set the bus on fire inside. It burned for almost 3 hours. By the time, it had all burned. The police came to secure the area.
That was the mayor of Viry-Châtillon. He believes TikTok helped the riots spread to his town and helped to explain how intense they became.
TikTok was used by different neighbourhoods to show how much more violent they could be, always more extreme in the abuses that could be done. And so, by force of circumstance, and unfortunately, once the riot started, TikTok became a tool to show here, this is what I'm capable of doing. Can you do better? What is incredible and dramatic is that these riots actually took place in working-class neighbourhoods, but also in the provinces, in cities, in small towns where nothing is happening, where everything's fine, where people are happy. Well, despite everything, there are town halls that have been burnt, while there are small towns where everything's going well and where there are no particular problems.
When I asked former employee Lucas about whether TikTok is good or bad for the world, his answer was stark.
I think it's probably a net negative. I don't believe that a platform of short addictive videos consuming so much of our time can be a positive thing. It takes people away from real life interactions and spaces. I think it can dehumanize people to some extent. And I think it also promotes some dangerous and unhealthy behaviors.
Former moderator Jasmine doesn't believe it's possible for TikTok to get on top of the frenzies on its platform.
As a moderator, it felt like you were there as kind of a front for TikTok to say that they were trying their best, but you were very much aware while you were moderating that this is an impossible task because of the speed of how quickly someone can upload something and it being available for everyone to see. You're constantly playing catch up with like an invisible beast, which the algorithm is.
Having spoken to TikTok insiders and people caught up in these frenzies, it seems to me that they're really difficult to get on top of. And not just that, but there isn't really the incentive to do so. After all, a slower, less participatory TikTok doesn't seem to be a goal for the social media company. I asked TikTok about all of the frenzies I've outlined. A spokesperson for the social media company said that our algorithm brings together communities while prioritising safety, for example, by recommending different types of content and interrupting repetitive patterns. In addition, we remove harmful misinformation, with the vast majority of videos never receiving a single view, and we demote and significantly reduce the reach of videos that contain unverified information. Prioritising safety is not only the right thing to do, it makes business sense. We have more than 40,000 safety professionals working alongside technology to protect our community. And as we learn more, we do more, which is why we continue to collaborate with academics, law enforcement agencies, nonprofits, and other experts to evolve our processes. That's it for this edition of BBC Trending's Extreme Series with me, Marianna Spring. A huge thanks to producers Beth Godwin and Olivia Lace-Evans and the team at BBC Three. If you want to get in touch about this episode, then you can do so by emailing me at marianna.spring@bbc.co.uk. We're also on Facebook and Twitter. Just search for BBC Trending and follow us. And remember to leave us a rating or a review wherever you get your podcasts from.